Welcome to another Beyond Barriers podcast. We have a very special guest with us today, Dr. Craig McCann. He is an independent specialist advisor and researcher as director of Spectrum, strategic preventative expertise to counter terrorism risks using upstream measures, Universal LTD. He provides consultative services for domestic clients and international development programs with an emphasis on preventative counterterrorism strategy and delivery. He also writes, advises, lectures, and provides commentary on the UK Prevent Strategy, de-radicalization, disengagement programming, and online approaches to counterterrorism and response to right-wing extremism. Dr. McCann also holds a law degree and an MA in criminology from the University of Kent at Canterbury. And at the same university, he completed his PhD, which explored how the UK Prevent Strategy has been applied to right-wing extremism since 2011. He also converted this thesis into a book titled The Prevent Strategy and Right-Wing Extremism, a case study of the English Defense League, which has been published as part of the Rutledge Extremism and Democracy Range. Welcome, Craig. Thanks for joining us.
Thanks for having me.
Thank you. Now, first, we're going to just kind of jump in here. You had an article recently that was originally published by CAR, Center for Analysis of the Radical Right, Beware the Anti-Fascists, for They Have Become What They Oppose. And this actually created quite the controversy. Can you tell us a little bit first, because I don't think a lot of people get to, they might just read an article that somebody has written, but they don't ever get to hear what prompted somebody to write such an article. Can you give us a little bit of the mindset of what you were thinking and why you felt it was important to actually write this article?
Yeah, sure. So I suppose I, for many years, have been working originally in the counter-Islamist terrorism space, and then shifted gears in around 2009-10 to look at more more the right wing, so right wing terrorism, and the evolution of our strategic approach to counterterrorism has followed that, it's very much gone in that direction. So we're very much focused on Islamist terrorism post 9/11. When it got to around, you know, to the 8, 9, 10, started to think about all forms of terrorism, because there had been an increase in threats from the right of the spectrum. Then I suppose over the last 2 or 3 years, I've seen the rise of the threat emanating from left-wing terrorism. When you look at things like TSAT reporting from across the European Union, you're seeing the threat from left-wing groups start to really hit the headlines. You know, particularly think about places like Italy, Spain, and Greece. So groups that aren't in that street protest sphere, they are very much bona fide terrorist organisations committing terrorist acts. And I suppose what prompted me to write the article is as much as we thought that we had a blind spot when it came to right-wing terrorism back in 2008-9, I think we've very much got a blind spot now in when we think about left-wing terrorism and what some people will justify based upon ideologies that sit within the left. And I found myself coming across chatter online. You know, still a lot of work with activists and with intervention providers who work with governments to work with individuals who may be vulnerable to being drawn into terrorism. And yeah, there's a real consensus view that some of the tactics that are creeping into groups like Antifa, for instance, are emulating those that we saw on the right of the dynamic, you know, and I quoted in the article the phrase it's okay or justification to flatten the nose or to brass knuckle up and flatten the nose of a Proud Boy, and I was making the case that actually if you're advocating for political violence against those who are your diametric opposition, then maybe you'll know better than them. in terms of the justification of political violence. I got a, probably fair to say, a significant backlash, particularly from accounts on Twitter in the US. What I would say is that it was very interesting, actually, the level of backlash and some of the charges that were made against me. I was framed as an apologist for right-wing terrorism, but at no point did anyone really, I think, satisfactorily engage with the central argument, and that was that actually justification of political violence, why should we give those on the left a free pass with regards to what they justify on the streets when we condemn it for other, extremist groups? So it's been an interesting couple of weeks in terms of the response to the article, and unfortunately it's been removed from the CAR, the Center of Analysis of Radical Rights. It's been removed from their website because of the level of pressure they came under. And unfortunately, as well, the director of CAR, who is a tremendous character in this field, Professor Matthew Feldman, and he has done more to counter terrorism emanating from the radical right than all of these individuals who are angrily mashing their fingers into their laptops, all of them put together, frankly. And I think he really tried to create an atmosphere within CAR, which was a broad church, and he understood that we need actors from across all political persuasions to unite in the joint endeavor to counter all forms of political violence. And I suppose it's probably fair to say that I politically sit on the other side of that church to a lot of other individuals who are associated with CAR, but I have never had a problem working with people and other academics and people doing programming on the ground, as long as obviously we know what the rules of engagement are. But it's been very telling over the last couple of weeks how many individuals associated with CAR have, I think, abandoned the idea of broad church and have crept into, in my view, becoming apologists for political violence on the left. I'd go so far as to say that in some of the discourse that I've seen over the last couple of weeks.
Right. I wanted to say I thought your article was really fair and it covered those issues, and I mean, especially for all the years you've spent tackling the far right, just to point out something like that and to say, hey, we should condemn violence no matter what side it comes from. To me, that's not controversial. That's common sense, and that's why I was pretty shocked to see the level of animosity that came towards that statement and towards that article, because I don't feel that it was unfair. And coming as someone that had been an extremist on the far right, I can say that one of the things that a lot of the people on the far right believe is they see the far left getting away with certain things. And we monitor, one of the things we do at Beyond Barriers too is we monitor this chatter. Not only do we know these people from when we were there years back, but we also monitor their chatter. And you hear things like, well, so what happened on January 6th? Because in 2020, the riots and the burnings and the lootings, that was, way worse than what we did. It's always this balance. They say, well, they're just as bad, or no, they're worse. And I hear that all the time too. It's sort of like, well, Nazism was bad, but communism was worse, or communism was worse, or vice versa, and that sort of thing. And that's how an extremist balances this stuff. They say, well, it's really not that extreme because these people are getting away with it, so why can't we get away with it? So I felt like it was an article, and it was something that needed to be said, and the fact that there was this backlash over it, over just being fair. I don't think, I feel, this is just my opinion, but I don't feel like you said anything that was over the top or wrong or really that controversial, and it shouldn't have been reacted to in that manner. Because if we don't look at all forms of extremism and tackle these issues fairly, fair is the key word here, and not let our own personal opinions get in the way of that sort of thing, it's the problems are going to exasperate, they're going to get worse, and that's why I thought it was courageous, even though you did take flack for it, and I'm sure you still are. It should have been said, and you should have had more support in my opinion on that. But I'm not getting into the politics of all that or anything like that. But I just wanted to say we felt like it was a good thing to do because it's fair.
Yeah, no, thanks. And I know, and you know, that Twitter is not the real world, and the distinct and very small echo chamber that is obviously a lot of these accounts that did vociferously attack me and the article and also Professor Feldman and Carr itself for even having the audacity to publish the article. That's not representative of normal people. Absolutely not. So then we've got to bear in mind the nature of the backlash, because actually I've spoken to many practitioners, including members of CAR itself, who have reached out to me by way of support over the last couple of weeks and said, look, you know, don't necessarily want to raise my head above the parapet, but I just want to say I agree with every word you say. So I think practitioners working in the space who understand risk, threat, and vulnerability, they read the piece, and actually they know me as well, and they know my record, which I stand by, and they know that all these charges that I'm some kind of fascist, they just don't pass the smell test, frankly, you know. And so I take solace from that. I've put something out there that has at least precipitated a conversation that needs to be had. I suppose the impact that couldn't be foreseen. I mean, you know, you're always going to get some flack online from people, you know, and some of the issues that I've touched upon in the article obviously didn't sit well with people that are in that space. And actually, in their response, they have proven my argument. In the fact that, you know, actually all the nastiness that's out there and the justification for violence, when you think about the rebuttal article that was written by a guy, you know, obviously still within CAR, you know, things were said there like, you know, maybe I was charged with creating a bit of a straw man, you know, when it comes to Antifa and some of the individuals affiliated with the organisation. And we've got to be really careful about the nature of some of these groups, movements, organizations, because I've studied the far right for years, and you're never a card carrying member of these organizations. You can loosely be joined to or have an affiliation with a brand because you're ideologically aligned to them. You can very much buy into it, but you don't pay a subscription anymore. You are part of a loose network of followers. So we've got to be careful about, you know, banning, you know, things like members of or adherence to. But it was, I think for me, it was very, very clear that in the charge that I'm creating a bit of a straw man, I mean, I really challenge that, because I think even the FBI in the States has moved from, you know, this, you know, framing of Antifa as an idea to actually recognizing that there are organized nodes at the local level, organizers, you know, mobilizing people, that this has got a significant online footprint. You know, this is going to be, and there is a number of individuals who are or have been and who are being under investigation for criminal offenses dropping out of street protests. So I think we've got to take this seriously. I think there are too many academics and too many activists, and, you know, a very, very blurry line between the two nowadays, who are not just turning a blind eye to the political violence associated with these groups, movements, organisations, but they're also condemning those that highlight it. such as myself. So to have the audacity to even, you know, raise it as an issue, you get stomped on. Or in their view, they just want to silence you. They want to censor any kind of conversation that that is uncomfortable for them. But so as much as I say that, you know, we could have anticipated a bit of a backlash online, I think the thing that was surprising was the response within CAR, because there were fellows that resigned over this, and then 27 of them got together and wrote an open letter calling for me to be kicked out of the research centre, questioning the leadership, and wanting to. I mean, if you read what the kind of list of demands, I mean, that should chill any researcher to the core. You know, it was very much an ideological takeover. We want to appoint our own committees to talk, to sign off on members. We want to take over the editorial process, so that all of the insights coming out from fellows, we want to say as to what goes out. You know, that is censorship every day of the week. You know, so there's very much a groupthink that I didn't realise that's there. And obviously in response to that, obviously Professor Feldman resigned as the founder director of CAR, and there's an acting director there now. And I think there's an announcement coming up this week where they're going to define the future of the organisation. But I think it's very dangerous that an organisation like that, with the reputation it had, has been subject to such an ideological takeover. Because where do you think it is that governments and police forces and academic institutions, where do you think they go to understand extremism? They go to groups like CAR. And if CAR is very much ideologically driven towards, turning that blind eye to political violence of the left, then they are no longer credible. They no longer have a say, and they can no longer be trusted to speak without fear of favour, to have credibility from a research perspective, to actually influence the conversation we need to have. So that's, I suppose, over the last couple of weeks, that's the thing that's really, I suppose, surprised many people, is that shift within CAR itself. But what I would say is, I've been heartened by the fact that so many people within CAR have reached out, and they applaud the article, very supportive, but then are very concerned about the future direction.
And I want to just say this in just general terms, because I don't have a foot in CAR or anything like that. But I want to say, like, from the work that we do at Beyond Barriers, we feel like it's incredibly important to be nonpartisan when you're doing this kind of work. Mm-hmm. When you're working in prevent, or you're working in de-radicalization, in the de-radicalization space, period, you have got to be nonpartisan. Of course, everybody has their own political beliefs. You can be right, you can be left, it doesn't matter. But don't be on the extremes. But when one of the things that I noticed right away getting out of the movement is that the people that we're helping to leave, the people that were walking out, they'll ask, you know, like, hey, are you with Antifa? Are you a communist? I mean, this is like the most common question they ask. Literally one after another that's reached out, they ask that. And I say, look, do you see anything in our online footprints, anything that we're putting out that would lead you to believe that? No, but I know other formers or other people do that. So I'm going to ask you. I'm going to say, no, we're nonpartisan. We'd stay away from that. And I think you have to be. And again, this is just my opinion. We're new on this side of things, but we know from living that life as extremists how these people think. And for research organizations, and I'm not naming anybody, because I'm not going to do that, you know, but if a research organization is picking sides in this and going, you know what, it's going to be ideological this way, you've already lost half the battle. You're not going to get people aren't going to change. You've created your own echo chamber now that's politically based. And the people that are trying, that are trying to change, they're like, okay, so I have one choice: to say it, stay on this extreme here on the far right, or go to this extreme on the far left. And neither one is a good choice. You need to be somewhere in the middle. You can be right, you can be left, you can be in the middle, be anywhere else, but stay away from those extremes. And the way they're viewing that when people are making these kind of ultimatums, or when even criticizing, even pointing out that, hey, there's issues over here. It's not just one side. And I've given talks with the government and different things like that too. And I've seen other, and again, I won't say, you know, who or anything like that, but I've seen other so-called experts talking about there's no extremism on the left. I saw a guy say that was one of the leading experts, say they're the only form of left-wing extremism I could find, he said, is going back into the 1960s. I about fell out of my chair. I was like, you've got to be kidding me. Of course, there's a lot more going on the far right, and that should be focused on, obviously. But if you can't point out the extremism on the other side, there's some kind of disconnect. There's something. I think it's an utter failure, and I think it's shameful, and I think it sets us back in the work that we're trying to do in de-radicalization in general, because it builds those echo chambers. So, sorry for the rant, but it leads me to my next question for you, Craig. Dialogue and civil discourse, in your work in Prevent, in your time in law enforcement and everything else, do you think that dialogue and civil discourse are important things that we should have in society today? Or do you think it's better to use cancel culture and cancel thoughts and opinions? I already know the answer to this, but I'm going to ask it anyways.
Well, I think this is why there is so much concern and pushback against cancel culture you hear the term woke a lot, don't you? You know, what is woke? Woke is being, you know, alive to the idea that there is prejudice out there and trying to overcome that, you know, trying to combat that as much as possible. So I kind of prefer to work from the basis that everyone is woke. We're all, you know, in terms of our level of awareness, our level of, you know, the level of information that we've now got access to, the networks, I think we're all, you know, in terms of, humanity in the year 2022, I think there's never been a better time, you know, to be, living in our societies. The number of laws that we have, the kind of cultural awakening that we've had in terms of equality. And I think there's a lot of people that would decry that and say, well, you know, and would prefer to focus on the past than the present and the future. And I think there is a very pernicious, I think way of thinking that it's taken hold, particularly within social media. And let's not forget that social media encourages this, just because it's the way that this stuff is built. It's about relevance, and it's if you have a particular way of thinking, it's very easy to fall into a tribe on social media. And I've said this time and time again, social media didn't make people bad, but it brought the bad out in people because of the way that we use this stuff. So I think the term woke has been hijacked in many ways by people very much who are extreme in their thinking. When you think about cancel culture, I mean, this has been applied many, many times, and there's been almost a denial that it exists, which clearly doesn't. It clearly does exist. I mean, it's many, many high profile instances of this. What I would say is, from a kind of counterterrorism perspective, some of the language used to quell dissent and to remove people's voices. If we were talking about the right, we'd be using phraseology like dehumanization. We'd be talking about us and them thinking. We'd be talking about, I mean, these are the kind of factors that we look at in the disengagement space, you know, for intervention providers to work with individuals who may be vulnerable to going down these paths. Dehumanization is up there. You know, referring to people who are in opposition to you as rats and things like that. We've seen plenty of instances of that. Now, what's the difference between that and justifying going out and flattening someone's nose? You know, you are justifying violence against a human being because you no longer see them as a human being. It's very much us and them. So I think there is this you know, it's cancel culture. It's this say very pernicious strand of thinking within our discourse at the moment, where it's very easy to drop into those echo chambers online. Sometimes, I mean, I left Twitter about Christmas time, and I've got to say, I've never felt so good, because it's very easy to get drawn into this very negative spiraling way of thinking, that there is rampant inequality out there, that there, you know, we're going backwards in many ways. Well, actually, I think we need to champion a lot of the successes that we've got. And oftentimes it's people speaking on behalf of minority communities rather than minority communities talking on their own behalf. And I think sometimes their voice gets crowded out by the more militant lobbies, who actually have very big profiles on social media and use it to gather, you know, to get their views out there and to cause division. So I think there is, I mean, it's a fascinating study in and of itself, just how some of these echo chambers influence the broader discourse, because people do, you know, you look at news headlines now, and they're taking snapshots off Twitter. Why are we allowing sometimes the kind of lowest common denominator in the thinking? You know, these are not expert opinions. These are random people on Twitter. We're elevating them to a status that they simply don't deserve. These are not experts. These are not people that have gone out there and walked the walk. And yet, because they title themselves activist or anti-fascist even, they have an elevated sense of their own status in the discourse. And I tend to find it's very, very negative. It's very divisive, not helpful at all to actual practitioners such as ourselves, who are actually trying to go out there and bridge divides. I mean, I've sat with community groups for years, within the police service, outside the police service, facilitated conversations to talk about the local tensions, having some difficult conversations and going to places where sometimes people fear to tread. And actually, that's the only way that you're going to start bridging these divides. You won't do that through cancel culture and having a safe space. Sometimes the most needed conversations need to take place in unsafe spaces. You need to have the courage to go there and actually talk to people about things like the changing demographics in a local town. You know, that's in some places that's a real issue. We had big problems, obviously, lots of divisiveness around our Brexit vote. You know, we didn't have, in the wake of that, a really concerted, proactive effort to go out into communities to actually have the difficult conversations. You know, because it's just easier to shy away from it and allow. What we do is we cede ground to the extremes. And the extremes that have a very big voice on or an elevated platform on social media. And that's a big danger for us as practitioners, because, you know, go back to those labeling themselves anti-fascists who you know, this huge backlash against the article. They're not helping at all. They're getting in the way of actual practitioners. And, you know, cynically, I nodded to this as well, they often like to be the arsonist and the firefighter, so to go in and stir the pot and create a lot of division and then come up with the solutions to it. So there's very much a self-interest at play here for many of the actors that you see in this space.
Absolutely. Now, one question I also had is, being that you're in the UK and we're in the US, and I never realized it as much until I left the far right and started looking at other places other than the US and how it's the same but differs, the problems that we see with the right-wing extremism and the left-wing extremism. Now, being that you're in the UK, have you seen, or maybe did you get more of a backlash from the left here in the US than you did in the UK? Or... did that kind of...
Yeah. It was very much led from the US. And that's the, you know, when you think about these networks, that's where it exists. I think culturally, we, in terms of the conversation around counterterrorism and counter-extremism and the framing CVE, which I've written about this before. See, CVE is an aberration in many ways of counterterrorism work and you know, good old-fashioned community cohesion work. But that's probably a conversation for another day. But I think the main, the most significant backlash was from the US. But I think culturally, when we have these conversations about CT, for instance, we very much take the lead from the states on this. So there is think back to kind of the war on terrorism, and then obviously latterly, certainly over the last 10 or so years, the shifts towards right-wing terrorism, very much led by the US. I mean, we very much follow, and there are many of us that would say that we need to be taking more of a lead. I mean, I'd say that our prevent approach is better in the UK than it is in the US. I think there is there's a whole multitude of reasons for that. I think we made a lot of mistakes on the way. Don't get me wrong. We stepped in a whole bunch of potholes in the development of that. But I'd go so far as to say that our prevent strand within our counterterrorism strategy is world leading right now. And I do a lot of work in international development. I do very much believe that. I think the investments and the thought leadership on that has been second to none. But I think in terms of the cultural leading the conversation on things like political correctness, cancel culture, these are things that we are inheriting from, you know, our American brothers and sisters, unfortunately. And we saw this cancel culture, it took root in American universities first. And there are a lot of people here that say it never happened over here. Well, it has happened over here. You know, we very much, I mean, it started with yourselves, and we very much imported it. And it's now permeated into our media, you know, our broader kind of academic circles. And there is, a concerted pushback against that. There was a study I read that suggested that, you know, based upon it was survey data with academics from a whole range of different universities, that those academics that would define themselves as maybe sitting on the right of the spectrum, so center right in their leaning, definitely felt more of the chill of cancel culture than the left, but significantly many academics on the left also felt it. So it's not something we can deny the existence of. It's been very interesting seeing how this has shifted over time, and that there was, I think, some probably self-assured people over here that would say, you know, that's happened in the States, it will never happen here. Well, it has. You know, we have very much imported that. Where this goes next, who knows? You know, is it going to get worse before it gets better? But I do see there's a very much a kind of cultural clash going on. For me, one of the best things people can do is get themselves off social media. And I think it can be a very, very positive thing, but I think at the moment it's toxic. And it's very much, if you're going there, pick a tribe. And if you don't want to pick a tribe, you're going to be left on the sidelines. That's a very dangerous place to be.
We know that all too well, you know, being neutral on things. And I've said it a million times, like, I never thought, like, being in the middle and being neutral on this stuff and being, you know, I can't think of the word now, but nonpartisan would be a controversial thing. Like, yeah. Being neutral is. And I think radicalization, just from my experience and from our experience, is reciprocal. Like, if you have radicalization on one side, you're going to have it on the other. And if you look at it through a lens and just say, it's just this one side, you only have half the picture. You can't balance it, because a lot of times it's reciprocal. And I've got examples of that from the time in the movement when there was clashes. you know, it radicalized people. It got people more pumped up to go to things and things like that. When there was, you know, like the old saying goes, if a tree falls in the woods and no one hears it, you know, does it make a sound? Yeah. You know, at those events where there was no counter demonstrators, nobody to fight with, it was demoralizing for the people on the far right to be there. And, yeah. You know, from my perspective in the past as a leader, I worried at that point, like, wow, are we going to have people showing up at the next rally? So, I mean, that should be telling. That should be something that people go, wait a minute. So, you know, I'm not saying that necessarily, I don't have all the answers, and I'm not saying that people should ignore it either, but I am saying that when there's violence, that tends to spike things up, that tends to push people back into those echo chambers that they're already in and things like that. But I'm glad you mentioned the prevent strategy there in the UK, and I've heard is very good over there. And I'm just curious about a little bit about that, and I have some questions. Something came up, and I just wrote this one down. But someone was talking about mentoring and prevent, and how important do you feel that is? I think that's a good question.
Yeah, sure. So I think within our prevention, we have what we call the channel program. So this is it's you hear the term whole of government, whole of society approach. Well, this is where the tires hit the tarmac very much. In that, if an individual is identified as having certain vulnerabilities, certain needs, and they may be being drawn into terrorism. So they're being targeted by a group. They may be coming out with narratives at school or in their workplace. There's a mechanism whereby they can be referred to, initially they might be their employer or their school, or their college. A lot of people have now been trained in making referrals to prevent and have a much better understanding of some of the factors at play here. But then ultimately, after many checks and balances to deconflict the information to find out if it's actually bona fide, if it's mischievous or if there's actually something to it, ultimately the individual can be offered to take part in an intervention. That was a consent-based program. So, and I personally have been to people's home addresses and sat down with them and their mums and their dads and said, look, you know, based upon your conduct at school, for instance, you've come up with the following comments. We would like to introduce you to an individual who is maybe a former extremist themselves, maybe a mentor within, you know, a local community group, to have some conversations, you know, to see where it goes, you know, to maybe broaden your horizons, you know. And what we tended to find is, it's very ironic actually, because one of the charges laid at the door of prevent was that it chills debate, chills conversation. It was never my experience of it, because what we tended to find is that the individuals who were in this space between kind of, you know, racism and poorly integrated perhaps, and terrorism, so these are the people that were sitting in this space that were vulnerable and maybe on the periphery of going into terrorism. Now they had their minds closed to alternatives. So one of the big things that recruiters do is they drive wedges between the individual and forms of information, because they want to be the only form of information or the only means of getting information for the person. So they'll drive wedges between the person and their friends and family. They'll discredit their government, their police service, and it's all about trying to whittle away alternative perspectives. So my experience of channel is that oftentimes through conversations we would get people to think a bit more critically about what they've been told, you know, and I never found it as restrictive. It was more liberating, you know. So we'd encourage them to read, read these books, go and expand your horizons, speak to these people. And what we tended to find is that in breaking down the walls of that echo chamber, we could actually liberate them from very dangerous ways of thinking about things and justifying violence and going back to things like dehumanizing people. So we do things like, well, you know, if you're on the far right, let's get you to meet a Muslim. You know, let's get you down to local. And we'd work with community groups who'd facilitate this, and you know, and you'd you'd sit two guys together and they'd be on completely opposite sides of the spectrum, but they'd find out that they support the same football team, you know, and they can, you know, talking about shooting the breeze and talking about some of the commonalities about the estates they grew up on, and, you know, and they know they're kind of the same people. And that's what this is all about. And this is the, you know, as I say, the non-safe spaces we have to work in. The channel is it's a multi-agency approach to the problem. You know, it's very much, you know, so police working with health and education partners, NGOs, and bringing all of those perspectives to bear on coming up with the best intervention for an individual. Some of the best work I've done is within channel, and I very much work in that space internationally now, because I've not seen an approach that is better at managing some of the risks associated with these individuals, and trying to meet some, you know, meet their needs to divert them away from those pathways to harm. But yeah, that's the, it's a distinct irony for me when you have people badging themselves as activists, and they're I think I go back to, it was something that Barack Obama said years ago, and he said, if you think that calling people out on Twitter is activism, that's not activism. Activism is actually, you know, walking the streets and meeting people and, you know, getting involved in conversations and local issues. This call out culture that people are now badging up as activism is not helping anyone. It's actually creating more division. My experience of channel is very positive, and certainly I had a guy that I was managing within channel. He was very much being groomed for a leadership position within the far right in the UK. And we managed to divert him away, and we got him, some of this is about just keeping people busy, you know, giving them something to do so they don't have to hang around the group, you know. And for him, it was getting him into employment. So we got him onto a bricklaying course. He then found a new social group. Positive influences, you know, protective factors were introduced. I mean, he then met a girl, and good luck to him. He got on with the rest of his life. And really, because we supported him so much during those months, he wrote a letter to me at the end and said, thank you for all you've done for me, you know, because I was going down a dangerous path. Can I please stay on channel? You know, because it's such a positive thing for me. But I mean, we can't keep people on the program, you know, so they've got to go off and stand on their own 2 feet at one point. But yeah, I think it just demonstrates the value of that level of emphasis and investment in individuals.
Absolutely.
I agree 100%.
That's amazing. And it's true. And like you mentioned, you know, sometimes it's just a matter of keeping somebody busy and being able to provide them opportunities. That way they're able to see that there is something other than this echo chamber that they're surrounded with. I know in my own journey, part of the reason that I got so involved so fast is because I did have extra time on my hands, and I did social media and video and podcasts, and suddenly my skills are being appreciated and they're being used, not in the correct manner, but... And it created a doorway, and it was a very fast and slippery slope. So I agree with that. And like you know, it's exactly right, you know, creating an echo chamber so that they can't hear any other opinions. I know Jeff has said this before about how, you know, you have to be open-minded to a certain degree to go in. But once you're in, you become very closed-minded to anything. Yeah. And so part of the way out is becoming open-minded again to other things. And you said it perfectly, like with that program, that's really, really awesome, the channel program, because it's giving people a chance, and it's preventative. You know, over here in the U.S., I think we're so enveloped in countering this that we forget the most important thing is learning how to prevent it from happening in the first place. You know, that's one thing at Beyond Barriers. Like, I'm very passionate about getting into the schools and working with the kids and, you know, teaching the relational dialogue and the civil discourse, because there's going to be people that you don't get along with, that you don't agree with, that, you know, politically are on opposite ends of the spectrum, but you have to be able to learn how to not look at it at them as the enemy and as the other and not othering, no matter what side of the political spectrum you're on. And if we can teach that at a very young age, it's a lot easier to prevent than it is to counter, because once they're already down that path, it's a whole lot harder to grab them and bring them back out. So
I think there's been a lot of emphasis, and you see this, you know, critical thinking programs in schools to do just that. I don't think there's nearly enough investment in that, but I do think sometimes it's closing the stable door after the horse has bolted in many ways. And what do I mean by that? Well, actually, a lot of children's behavior is learned behavior from their parents, and our generation have grown, it's exploded over the last few years, you know, the crutch of social media, you know, so we have really been drawn into this space. And now you're starting to see, it was a great program, The Social Dilemma, I saw on Netflix not too long ago, about how all of this stuff is altering our brain chemistry in not great ways, in that we are chasing likes and therefore having to be more controversial. And you're seeing adults, and they're going down these dark alleys and manifesting these behaviors. And who's in the room, you know, learning from this? Their kids. You know, so as much as we focus our energies on children, I think there's certainly some work to do on digital literacy, on critical thinking for adults, because I've seen very credible people that I know, and they've been drawn into spats on Twitter, and you think, just put your phone down. It's just, this is not real life. As I say, if you were to go onto Twitter, you'd feel so depressed at the general state of things, because you think there's rampant inequality out there, and that there's doom and gloom, and there's nothing you can do about it. And particularly if you're a white heterosexual man, you know, the way that you're framed in terms of your influence on this and the say that you have within these conversations. I speak to a lot of intervention providers who are working in this space, and they said that it's so damaging to some of the clients that we're working with, because they feel as if they've been portrayed as the enemy, and they're the other, and they're no longer human. They don't have a say on their lives anymore, because of what they are, as opposed to who they are and what they do. My big message to a lot of people is to focus very much on put your phone down and go and spend some time with friends and family, and just get away from the stuff, because that's you'll find a lot more, that the world is a lot more positive than social media would have you believe, and actually we are nowhere near as divided as is portrayed online. You strike up a conversation with a stranger, and after many years of being in the police service, I do believe very much in the power of people to be, you know, the goodness in people. And I've seen it, don't get me wrong, I've seen the bad, but I think overwhelmingly you've seen the good. But this recent experience of this backlash, I think I'm in a position where, you know, within my career, where I know this what it is, actually, and I know just how unrepresentative these views that you see over the last couple of weeks, how unrepresentative that actually is of normal people, and I take great solace in that.
Yes.
So could you tell us a little bit about the book that you wrote, and if people are interested, where they could get that?
Yeah, sure. So I was really keen to look at how we apply prevent to right-wing extremism in the UK. And really the biggest gig in town when it comes to right-wing extremism at the time, from about 2009 onwards, was the English Defence League. What I found through, I did a lot of interviews with practitioners, about 80 or so interviews up and down the country. I looked at three case study areas. And I actually started the PhD while I was a serving police officer. So I was the head of strategy and policy within Prevent Policing, and I, you know, had pretty good networks. And actually I found, on speaking to people, that there was this general consensus that the kind of that the EDL had never posed a terrorist threat. They were not a terrorist organization. They've been sent in plenty of attempts to prescribe them as a terrorist organization, but it just never, they never hit that criteria. They were, you know, the victims of terrorist attacks, but never causing terrorism themselves. So they were very much a street protest movement. And what I found was that, okay, they'd never posed a terrorist threat, but they certainly had posed a community cohesion threat. Anytime they turned up, they stirred up tensions locally. That can't be denied at all. I mean, that was, in many ways, the biggest threat they ever posed. And you saw this, you know, when you had the EDL announced they were coming to a particular town, you just saw the opening of old wounds. You know, it's exposed it to the world, because obviously the national media would come down and they'd start looking at what's going on here, what surface tensions are bubbling. So it really exposed a lot of that. So yes, a community cohesion threat, and also a public order threat, because they turn up in thousands. You know, numbers would turn up and they'd you'd have the police would shut down the town and say, you know, business is closed, because obviously the huge numbers of people coming in, the high prospect of fights on the streets. And then what you found is this mobilization of counter protesters. Then you started to see a lot of you know, fights in the streets, criminal damage. So one of the central conclusions from the book is that whereas we focused on the counterterrorism space, very much the poor cousin. When we think about policy, it's the poor cousin when we think about policy development is very much in our community cohesion integration space. And when it's very easy to kind of erode that first step on the journey. So you don't focus enough time and effort and energy in building strong communities, but you focus on extremism and terrorism. Well, you need to come back from that. You know, you hear practitioners talking about the upstream space. Well, there is no more upstream space than the way that we build relationships that has nothing to do with terrorism. You know, and I see this, whereas we've got a world leading counterterrorism strategy, look across at our community integration strategy, and that's where we certainly need a lot of work. We need a huge amount of emphasis on that, because we can actually get in front of a lot of issues when we think about prevent. This is prevent. You know, this is where we need to be to stop people even encroaching into this sphere that we call counterterrorism. So one of my central conclusions was just that actually we are at risk of overly securitizing this sector, much as we did with Islamist terrorism in many ways. So we learned mistakes from the past, or we just repeating them. So very much pointing towards community integration as being the area of the most need, and I'd say in all my international development work, I've drawn the same conclusion from a lot of jurisdictions, and you see the prevailing wisdom of counter extremism, counter terrorism coming in. Well, actually, you need to take a beat and think about what is it you need to get in place first before you even think about counter terrorism.
Excellent. That's so awesome. Where could someone get the book if they want to get it?
Oh, sure. So so it's on the it's published through the Routledge Extremism and Democracy range. Excellent.
I'll make sure to put a link for that in the description below in the video.
Great. So, no, thank you.
Absolutely. Definitely. And did you have any other questions, Jeff? Because
no, I think we're at about an hour or so. I was going to just ask you that.
We're almost out of time, but I definitely would love to have you back on for another conversation. There's so much that, you know, we can learn, and, you know, you're very knowledgeable about what you do, because not only, you know, have you researched it, but you've been in the thick of it, and you've, you know, from all angles. So I thank you very much, and thank you for having the courage to, you know, speak the truth, and knowing that you are going to get flack, you know, from all sides, because, you know, sometimes when you try to point out the wrongs on each side, nobody really likes it. I really appreciate it. And I just wanted to end with actually the last line of your article, because I think it can be applied in so many different areas of people's life, not just in extremism. But what you said is that to those who advocate for violence against those you oppose, take a good look in the mirror, for you may have become that which you hate. And this can go for anybody, whether it's politics, society, everything. You know, you might have a righteous cause, but make sure that you're not using the tactics of those that you oppose, because you will become that which you oppose. So thank you again. I really appreciate you coming on.
No, thank you very much indeed for having me. It's been great talking to you.